Good morning, everyone. Welcome back to the Peterson Institute for International Economics. I'm Adam Posen, president of the Institute, and it's a real privilege today to welcome many friends from around the world, around the country, very distinguished scholars and practitioners, for what we hope is going to be an extremely revealing and stimulating day talking about the global productivity slowdown. We're starting a bit late today because of events in Washington. Thanks to everyone on the web, as well as those who came through the transit mess to be here with us in person. Thankfully, it is not something that people need to concern themselves with or we need to feel bad about. This is the first major effort by the Institute to try to grapple with the productivity issue in some time. And we have been, of course, dealing with aspects of it, but there are many others in the world who have been leading the discussion, many of whom are with us today, and we're very proud of our convening power that we could bring together such a stellar group. We'll be talking, you'll be hearing more about them and their views throughout the day. But the main point I want you to think about is really where do we go next? And it's where do we go next in two senses. First, what are the research questions we have to tackle? We, the Peterson Institute, but also we, the applied, right, reasonable, empirical part of the profession. Where do we go from here? We have a number of theories specific to the US, general across countries, that we're going to be addressing. We will be having a major luncheon address by Lawrence Summers on work he and our new colleague Olivier Blanchard and others have been doing on the not only secular stagnation, but the transition from hysteresis into long-term slowdown. We will be having, at the end of the day, an off-the-record discussion with Robert Gordon, who, of course, did much to start this discussion in motion. And the rest of the day will all be on the record. The summer speech will be on the record as well. I don't want to belabor this. We should get right into substance. I will just make two additional points. First, we at the Peterson Institute are grateful to our many friends who put in the effort to come and participate, but I want to thank in particular Royal Dutch Shell, whose chairman, Ben Van Burden, is on our board of directors, and the company and the team led by Jeremy Bentham. Has been a huge partner of ours, both substantively and in their generous support for many years. And we're grateful to have this as a new example of the partnership with their support. And another significant, longstanding charitable supporter of the Institute has also helped make this possible, who asked not to be identified. We're always grateful for such generosity without credit. Second, just substantively, organizationally, the emphasis today was asking people who've already made major contributions to distill down their work and present it in a form that allows us to interact and compare various perspectives. We're particularly grateful today, our second panel, which will be chaired by my colleague Jacob von Kierkegaard, to have experts world-class on five countries outside the US, China, the UK, looking at the region of Southern Europe, Japan, and China, Japan, UK, Germany. Ah, yes, my favorite. As I sit here with the distinguished Marcel Fratscher staring me in the face. Germany, my longtime favorite, because this truly is a global question. The challenge, I think, has been that for many of us, there was no question that a global financial crisis would have lasting impact on productivity in a negative way. What was more troubling for many of us, which was the concern that bad performance coming out of the crisis, which could be considered in some sense cyclical, or at least in a sense temporary, would be redefined as trend growth and therefore assume the slowdown that happened and become self-fulfilling. While I think a number of us successfully fought that impulse for good reason during the policy decisions in the early crisis years, there is now at least as good reason from the accumulated research and data of many of the people participating with us today to recognize that the slowdown is more than that, and that the productivity slowdown did indeed probably start in many countries even before the crisis, and its causes may be independent of the financial crisis, even if they certainly interacted with the financial crisis or made worse by that. So the questions we have about what to research next are also, therefore, about what is the feasible policy response in a world where we can all talk about structural reforms, but this seems to be besetting countries that even on the OECD's magic scale do seem to be pretty well off in terms of their liberalization. So it's a very exciting event, it's a very important event, and I'm grateful to have you and all my colleagues here today. I'd like to call on David Stockton, senior fellow here at the Institute, to chair the first panel, which is looking at explanations of the U.S. slowdown. Dave.
Well, Larry Summers is purported to have said that if you've never missed an airplane, you've spent too much time in airports. I tested the proposition this morning that if you've never missed chairing a session, you've probably gotten up too early most of your life. But here I am, so I'm still getting up too early, evidently. We've got three, I think, very interesting, important, and different papers on the productivity situation in the United States this morning, and I'm looking forward to that. Quite a bit. Our participants in the first session are John Fernald, a former colleague of mine from the Federal Reserve, a senior research advisor at the San Francisco Fed, and I think without much exaggeration, one of the leading scholars in the area of productivity research in the United States. We also have Jana Rames from McKinsey Global Institute, who is a partner and economist there, and she's led the Global Institute's research on productivity, urbanization, and competitiveness and growth in recent years. I think she brings a very interesting perspective and detailed perspective to the outlook for productivity and some of the issues around that. And we have Peter Orszag also presenting his paper. Peter, most importantly, has been an important friend, a board member for the Peterson Institute of International Economics. Secondly, I'd say he's a vice chairman of corporate investment banking at Citigroup. And third, I guess we should mention, non-resident senior fellow in economic studies at the Brookings Institution. So without any further delay, let me call John Fernald to present the first paper.
All right, thank you. So I'm very pleased to be here. This is a great program for today. And as you know, Adam started out, I mean, the recent years have seen considerable disappointment on the productivity numbers. I'm going to make the argument for the U.S. that productivity numbers have been pretty modest since before the Great Recession. Sort of in the 4 years prior to the Great Recession, they've been not so different than what we've seen since. And this has been a real disappointment, even especially the past 5 years in the U.S., where the numbers have looked a little bit worse. But as we'll hear about later on today, these modest numbers and concerning numbers for the U.S. Look good relative to a lot of advanced economies, certainly since 2008. So we'll hear about that more later. So basically, what I want to talk about is sort of make it sort of a couple of points. First is, starting at an aggregate level, labor and total factor productivity slowed down prior to the Great Recession. So in that sense, the timing makes it look like it is not the Great Recession itself, as Adam suggested. Now, you can think of lots of stories for that. So I'll look at industry data to get some sense of this. And what you do see is that the TFP slowdown was actually pretty broad-based across industries. It wasn't just sort of things that were doing unusually in housing in the mid-2000s or finance. Now, it was somewhat more noticeable and sharper in IT-intensive industries like market services. So wholesale and and retail trade, it was even sharper. That suggests that story industries that were using IT a lot maybe didn't get, sort of plucked the low-hanging fruit of the benefits of information technology. And maybe what we're seeing is more normal and incremental if inexorable, productivity gains at a modest pace. That's sort of my preferred take on this. Now, I'll then talk about one hypothesis that's gotten increasing attention, which is maybe we're just not measuring the gains. And so I'll talk a little bit about the measurement issues and measurement challenges in the U.S. context. We've always had measurement It's just not clear that it's gotten worse. And my view is it can't explain a broad-based slowdown in market-based TFP growth. So to start, let me put a bar chart for the U.S. business sector. So this goes back to 1947, based on quarterly data, and it's output per hour, or labor productivity growth. So roughly, that's a well-known fact. And we had very fast productivity growth in the roughly quarter century from the late 40s to the early 1970s, above 3% a year. Then those strong gains disappeared, and we've got only about 1.5% productivity growth for the next almost quarter century. And just about when we'd kind of come around to the view that was normal, the fast pace was not normal, well, then in the mid-90s, productivity growth, much to people's surprise, picked up again. No one was really forecasting that. We got another 8-9 years of pretty fast growth, back similar to what we saw after World War II, of around 3%. Well, if you play that forward from the period since 2003, I've now broken those dozen years into three bars. So the 4 years prior to the Great Recession, so from the end of 2003 to the end of 2007, then the 3 years that cover the recession and the early recovery, and then the almost 5 years since. It's 4.75 years in this chart. And so what you see is that in the run-up to the Great Recession, productivity growth was not much different than it was in the 70s and 80s, so 1.5%. Now, there was a temporary rebound, especially right after the Great Recession. And the numbers look a little better, but not as good. But then we've gotten much worse numbers since. Indeed, in the past 5 years, these numbers, the productivity numbers, I think are the worst we've seen in an expansion probably since the 19th century. So the quarterly data, it's certainly true. You haven't had an expansion this week. But in the annual data going further back, in an expansion, you haven't seen this in the U.S. Well, a lot could be going on in this, and so to get a little bit more sense of what's going on, let me start putting some economics on it. What I'm going to do is then break this into standard growth accounting pieces. So what I've done for these bars is the top piece is what Dale Jorgensen would call labor quality, what the Bureau of Labor Statistics calls labor composition. It's basically the effect of increases in education and the age profile of the population. So over time, the labor force has gotten more educated, or workers have gotten more educated, and so that should boost productivity. And so this is how the accounting says it worked. So that's been a steady contributor. One of the things I would note is when you get into if you look in the 2007 to 10 period, almost the end bar. Well, during the recession, we fired a whole lot of low-skilled workers. And so that made the productivity numbers look better. It added almost a percentage point to the productivity number. So that's not something that you would want to say is a good aspect of productivity gains. But then in the past 5 years, we've hired back some of those low-skilled workers. So that labor quality has added less than it did in 2007 and 8 and 9. That's actually a good thing that we've been hiring these people back. So that's the orange bar. The blue green bar is the effect of giving people more capital, more tools to work with, more equipment, more software, more structures. Also been a steady contributor. But if you look again at the 2007 to 10 period, well, not only were we firing low-skilled workers, but the workers who were left had lots of capital to work with. Essentially, this is the effect of diminishing marginal productivity of labor. You were moving up, moving back. So that also contributed to the strong productivity gains during and after the recession. And what's left is the residual total factor productivity. That, in the long run, is mostly going to be a reflection of innovation and technical change. Kind of broadly construed, it's anything we can't explain with education or capital, and there, if you look over the past dozen years, so those three bars, though the blue portion was pretty similar in all of them, and so the optimistic story about for the past 5 years is, we've been doing badly because in fact we've been getting capital shallowing, so that green bar is negative. We've been hiring so many people that that investment hasn't kept up. So, it's also true that capital growth picked up more slowly than hiring did. But even the hiring, the capital, the investment we've been doing would be enough to sustain stronger productivity growth going forward once we get hiring back to kind of a normal pace. But of course, a lot could be going on in an aggregate picture like this. So to get a, try to understand a little better why is productivity slowed down, what I want to do is focus now on these blue bars. So the part that is TFP or that we think is capturing innovation, at least over longer periods of time. And I'm going to turn to industry data to try to shed some light on the stories. So what this is showing is industry data from the Bureau of Labor Statistics for some different groupings of industries. Now, the BLS data go back to 1987, so it's in 1987 to 2013, and it's TFP growth for different industry subgroups. So the height of this bar is TFP growth over the periods shown, which are, again, the periods are a little different than what I showed before. So I've broken this into a couple of different pieces to kind of get some insight. So one thing you might think was going on, I mean, you certainly see from the heights of the bars, right, and that, you saw pickup from 95 to 2000, and then further to 2000 to 2004, and then this, it fell down. So the TFP piece looks the same as what we saw in the aggregate data. So one thing you might worry about is there was a lot of unusual things going on in the mid-2000s. Productivity growth was going, or housing was going crazy with a boom and bust. Finance was doing lots of unusual things. So mining was also doing booming with commodity prices kind of soaring in many areas. So one of the things I did is just do a grouping of what I'll call here bubble sectors or bubble industries. So things like finance, construction, mining, and agriculture. So that's that purple crosshatched piece. Well, that's not the source of the slowdown. That did contribute less after 2004, but quantitatively, the big part of the decline was everything else. Now, one of the things that in the late 90s especially got enormous attention was clearly very important was production of information technology products. Semiconductors and computers and the like. So that's 6% of GDP, and it was contributing half of TFP growth in the late 90s. Well, that contribution eased as you move forward into 2000 to 2004. I think it continued to ease in the 2007, as you keep moving forward. I think there are reasons to worry that the IT production part in the far right bar since 2007. Maybe it's shrunk too much, that there's some measurement issues there that I'll talk about in a minute. But that's still not the biggest thing that was going on after 2004. Well, if you look at market services, so I've broken it here and not into, I've previously broken into IT intensive and not IT intensive, but everyone has a different group of what's IT intensive. So here I've taken a different cut, which is market services. So things like wholesale and retail trade, information services, business services of various sorts. So you see this big boost in this in the 2000 and 2004 period. So it just sort of was contributing enormously to the productivity, to TFP gains then. So if you look and just think about wholesale and retail trade in the late 90s and early 2000s, Walmart and other businesses like that were transforming what was going on in that industry. I mean, they had much better business model, much better ability to use information technology to manage logistics, and so they used information technology to dramatically improve the efficiency of that industry. And at the same time, the firm level evidence suggests that low productivity mom and pops disappeared from the data. So an enormous amount of work from both the top down and the bottom up, of which I think John Van Rienen has done some of the best work on that. Really linked that to information technology. But you didn't know with those stories, how long would that keep going? I mean, you did a transformative change to distribution. Are you going to keep getting that? It's not at all clear how long that would keep going. And at least the industry data suggests that after 2003 or 4, that would kind of pluck the low-hanging fruit of those benefits. And then after that, the market services contributed really very little. Now, the green bit is everything else that's not there. So it's going to be mostly manufacturing and utilities. So that contributed a little bit less in 2004 to 7. What's really striking there is after 2007, that's really disappeared. That's gone negative. So I would summarize this as really a pretty broad-based slowdown in TFP across industry. So the bubble sectors look good. No, things like mining look very good since 2007. That's no surprise. So the negative side from this is since 2007, it's things like mining where we've gotten TFP growth, not anywhere else. So again, I will summarize this as there's some broad-based slowdown. Well, one way to summarize my takeaway on this is what Greg Ipp talked about the productivity paradox a couple of months ago when he, in the Wall Street Journal, he said, the things at which Google and its peers excel, from internet search to mobile software, are changing how we work, play, and communicate, yet have little discernible macroeconomic impact. Transformative innovation really is happening on the internet, it's just not happening anywhere else. Or as Martin Wolf put it a couple of years ago, today's information age is full of sound and fury, signifying little. Well, you can certainly raise a concern about that, of maybe what's going on is we're just not measuring the benefits. Maybe we don't have a productivity problem. Maybe we have a measurement problem, as the way that I think Hal Varian has been quoted as putting it. And certainly Goldman Sachs has pushed this view quite as well, and many others. So maybe the numbers just aren't keeping track with what's going on, and we're not measuring things. So the things that people point to as being real problems in the data are really, I see it as two main areas. One is deflators for capital goods. So things like specialized equipment, like MRI machines, which don't have as careful analysis of the quality improvements as general equipment, like computers. And we've shifted production towards doing more specialized equipment. And software is a problem. There's a lot of software that's sort of done custom and and in-house stuff, but doing quality adjustment for that is hard. And the second thing that people really point to is the fact is that we don't count a lot of the benefits of the free goods and that people get from the internet. So the benefits of Facebook and Google and so forth, the benefits you get from watching cat videos on the internet, that doesn't get counted in GDP. And certainly, introspection tells me I get a lot of benefit from watching cat videos on the internet. So maybe we want to think about about those things. So I'll take a minute. I'm not sure how I'm doing on time. Okay. Let's talk about these two arguments. So capital and why they don't actually change the conclusion. So if you think about capital goods, so the issue there is we're missing more of the quality change in these specialized areas. So David Byrne at the Board of Governors, plus and his various co-authors of his, have done a lot of work on that. And suggests that, indeed, this is important, and it probably adds up to 1/10 or 2/10 on GDP. So that on its own will not change the productivity numbers. Remember, the magnitude of what we need to explain is a slowdown after 2003 or 2004 of 2% 2 percentage points on labor productivity growth, and maybe 1.25 or 1.5% on TFP. So 1 or 2/10 won't close that gap. But it's actually worse than that. It doesn't change the facts about TFP growth and the broad-based TFP slowdown. Because what it means is that the industries that are using those capital goods, we can now explain more of their output growth through increases in capital per worker. So true capital was growing faster than measured. So their TFP growth was worse. So the broad-based slowdown in TFP growth is worse. You can even, if you work through the math, it actually turns out that aggregate TFP growth, the economy as a whole, is also worse. That the effect of using the sectors that use this is larger than the effect that you have faster true TFP growth in producing equipment than you are measuring in the accounts. So the capital goods slide says that maybe the TFP slowdown, the broad-based market TFP slowdown, was even worse. How about free digital goods available on the internet? Well, one of the ways I guess there are two ways I think about this. So one is that the things like Facebook and Google and TripAdvisor and so forth, they're free to us. We don't pay anything to use them. But where do they show up in the accounts? Well, they show up in the accounts as an intermediate input, that Facebook is like an ad agency. They sell ads to other companies. So they don't sell a final product to consumers. Well, in that regard, they're like free TV. Historically in the accounts, as people have noted, things like ABC and CBS and NBC with free television were not selling final consumption good to consumers. They were like ad agencies. They were selling advertisements. And because consumers didn't pay for it, they weren't counted in the account. So that conceptually has long been noted that that's not the right way to think about it. So one way to do this that's been proposed, and that some work by Leonard Nakamura and Rachel Sokovacek suggest is, let's think about how you would do it right if there was an imputed payment for this stuff. That's things like not just internet, but free radio and TV. Essentially, an advertising-supported print media. Well, you would do that to it. There's some imputed payment that households are doing. Well, they suggest this would actually add about 2 basis points a year to growth. So it's like almost nothing. So part of that is we have more free digital stuff, but we're also getting less of free TV and free print media supported by ads. Well, that doesn't seem like that's really capturing the benefits we're all getting. So another way to think about that is just think about the benefits to consumers by looking at, say, the value of time use. So that's sort of the way that Brynjolfsson and O do it, is sort of write down a utility function once you get benefits from this, and then try to calibrate it with value of the amount of time people spend on different activities. They get a much larger benefit from this. But conceptually, this isn't really market. This isn't market production. This is services you're producing at home. It's like when you go, if you buy a baseball glove and play, or buy a soccer ball and play soccer with your kids. Well, there's a little market transaction, but most of that time you're spending, you're getting enormous benefits outside the home from that. And conceptually, what you want to do is think of this as sort of a total net account of market and non-market activities. So this is a way that Dale Jorgensen has tried to suggest doing more total economic accounts. Bill Nordhaus suggests doing it with sort of having accounts that do a better job of capturing not just market activity, but non-market activity, all of our economic activities. But where I would come from that is to say, we can get enormous benefits, but it's not shifting the market production function from this. It's something going on in the non-market sector and in a technology that makes us more productive in non-market activities. So just to kind of start wrapping up, what do we expect going forward? So my best guess is that modest growth is the new normal. That we can debate all of the, I'm not going to reprise all of the discussions of the techno-optimists and techno-pessimists on this. And there's enormous uncertainty about what robots and machine learning will do in the future. But my basic take on the solo paradox of weak productivity growth is information technology is why we've been doing as well as we've been doing. It's the main locus of innovation that we've gotten. And it's providing enormous benefits. It's done that for 40 years and longer. And it will continue to do that. And it's added up to 0.5% on TFP growth and 1.5% on labor productivity growth. But there's enormous uncertainty about that. So we can point to, so statistically, projections are very, enormously uncertain. I will just point to one aspect that maybe poses an upside risk that's not simply robots and machine learning, and that's the fact that there's a lot more research and development being done globally. So, in the past, if you're looking 20 years ago, the only research and development that really mattered for frontier ideas was being done in a small number of advanced economies, U.S., Japan, Western Europe, maybe Canada. So you look now, China has been doing much more R&D. So this is R&D as a share of GDP. So that's exploding. Korea is exploding. We don't have the OECD doesn't have data on India, but anecdotally that's exploding. So effectively, there are many more people in the world looking for ideas, and so some of the benefits of those ideas plausibly spill across borders. So there are, you know, many more, you know, Albert Einsteins and Steve Jobses and, you know, in China and India, who maybe have an opportunity now to change the world going forward. So to wrap up, my main takeaway is that, you know, modest U.S. productivity growth looks like the new normal. The pre-Great Recession slowdown was pretty broad-based across industries. I don't think growing this measurement can explain that. And if anything, probably makes it a little bit worse. And in terms of the future, as I said, I think when it comes to, you know, I'd like to think that machine learning and robots and the global nature of R&D will really change things for the better and make the productivity numbers look better. But while I hope for the best, I'm not going to bet the budget on it. Thanks. Thanks.
Thank you, John. Janet, you want to provide a different perspective, or alternative perspective, I should put, not necessarily different.
Thank you very much. I don't think I will be bringing a very different perspective. I think we will be pretty consistent. Productivity has been a core research topic for McKinsey Global Institute for 25 years now. In fact, it was the only topic we studied for the first 10 years. So even though we have broadened our horizons and study more wider topics, it still is a big part of what we do. So we are thrilled about the increasing attention to the topic and very much appreciate the invitation to join today. Thank you, Adam, and the Peterson Institute. Given that McKinsey works with global companies on most sectors around the globe, we really think that our contribution to the productivity debates comes from shedding light on what is happening underneath the macroeconomic numbers at the company and industry level. And this really is reflected on the approach that we have used throughout. So if you read this chart from right to left, we start by looking at some of the productivity performance figures, whether it's level or growth, and start by looking at what is happening at the plant or storefront level. What explains the differences in typically labor productivity in our case? What is the technology people are using, how organization of functions and tasks is done, and what might be the differences in the mix of activities or mix of products that could explain some of those gaps. And when we have a sense of what's happening on the ground, we then look for ways in which the industry dynamics, the competitive dynamics, or the regulatory environment, the capital and labor markets, as well as the product market regulations might influence that. And we have used this approach over 25 years now, so we have a relatively broad base of industries and countries where we have looked at that. More than 20 industries, over 20 countries. So this is the database, if you want, that we draw on some of the insights on what drives productivity globally. So what I'll do in the next 10 minutes or so, a little bit more, is to describe what we see happening underneath the U.S. productivity growth and covering a lot of the same ground, actually, of the same time periods that John just covered, and then talk a little bit of what we see as the prospects for productivity growth, both in terms of where the opportunities are, as well as what might be the factors that could potentially kick productivity growth into a higher or lower gear. One of the challenges of interpreting the aggregate productivity numbers is that really what we see in the overall evolution is a result of individual sectors going through faster and slower periods of their productivity growth. Because obviously, while there is some parts of the productivity gains that are progressive, that continue to grow over time, there really are periods where you see industries go through transformations. And that makes it hard for us to, for example, interpret the aggregate data and predict what might happen in the future. So take the second half of the 1990s, really the time period, or rather the overall 1990s, but particularly the second half when we saw U.S. productivity growth accelerate and end the multiple decades of European catch-up and start pulling up further ahead from the other developed economies. It is tempting to look at this time period as a shift of overall productivity change, but actually when you look at the acceleration, there were two groups of industries that really explain most of the acceleration. On one hand, it was two IT-consuming sectors, which John mentioned already. It was semiconductors and computer electronics. This was a time period where it was actually the software tools that allowed semiconductor companies to really design transistors much, much faster, get into chips much faster, that reduced the time it took to upgrade to the next higher performing, faster, more powerful chip. And this was really what allowed the semiconductor industry to improve their performance, as well as the computer industry, where their output was growing as a result. And at the same time, we saw ADM start increasing competitive intensity to Intel. So we saw a pretty significant competitive speed up as well. And both of these factors together made these relatively small employment sectors see their productivity grow very, very fast. And that was a big contributor to the acceleration. But even bigger factor was really two large employment sectors, retail and wholesale. And exactly as John described, a lot of that story had to do with Walmart that first started to implement their own supply chain improvements from in the early part of the 1990s, improving the way their goods were delivered from suppliers to their stores. But even more importantly, because of the fact that they were rapidly gaining market share, growing threefold in their share in the early 1990s, that performance pressure, particularly through lower cost, then translated into a much broader-based transformation across the industry. And this was a very large employment impact. Retail is one of the biggest employers in the economy, as well as wholesale. And collectively, even though the acceleration in productivity was more modest, the overall impact on productivity growth was very high. In addition to the Walmart effect, this was, of course, also a very positive growth period. Consumer confidence was up, purchasing power was up. So consumers were at the same time also trading up to higher value goods. So think about wine bottles, for example. A $15 wine bottle doesn't take any more time to transport or deliver than the two-buck chuck. Yet when consumers shift into the higher value products, that translates directly into a higher productivity, whether it's in the cashier just swiping goods through. And all of these factors were really helping during the boom time. That started to slow down when you look at after 2000. When you look at the productivity growth across the different sectors, and what we have in this chart, by the way, my apologies for not having explained it before. On the horizontal axis, we have value-added growth. On the vertical one, we have employment growth. So basically, you see employment growth growing up and value-added growing on the right. And the size of the bubble reflects the contribution of the industry to the overall productivity growth. So this is the net contribution to the aggregate productivity growth. So the bigger the bubble, the bigger the contribution. Orange is good. Gray means it reduces aggregate productivity. So after 2000, when you look at the retail bubble, that clearly comes much smaller. A big impact of that was that after the 2001 downturn, consumers actually returned and shifted down into lower value products. I mean, you saw that particularly with the rise of a lot of the store brands, etc. But at the same time, also exactly as John was describing, we saw many of the benefits on the supply chain being worked through the economy. They had been adopted across the different kinds of retailers. And there was really that wave of productivity improvements enabled by the IT, that wave was ending. Instead, in that period, the growth really came from manufacturing. So if you think of the computer and electronics segment, for example, this is a period where still value added continued to grow very, very fast. The benefits of the speeding up of the output continued to be, but employment was declining very rapidly. And that translated into a very large increase in productivity. This was, of course, the time when a lot of the consolidation of the global computer industry, for example, happened in certain hubs in Asia. So a lot of the employment growth happened on those periods rather than here. But it wasn't just the computer electronics. It was also other manufacturing. So think of automotive, for example. This was an industry that had started feeling the competitive pressure of the Japanese and South Korean companies already in the 1990s. But in that period, the shift to SUVs and minivans really allowed value added to grow much faster. And a lot of the restructuring and the production processes didn't necessarily start in the 1990s. They started with the Wengens in the 2000s. And that's when you see a lot of employment decline and restructuring. And this really happened when you look across the different size establishments and companies. It really happened in the largest companies, in the establishments with 250,000 or more inhabitants. So these were this was a segment where you saw employment decline as a result of these efforts to improve performance. When you look at the smaller companies, this is where actually both employment and value added increased. You can think about the microbreweries and other kind of food processing plants, for example, that continued to grow even at that period. So that was the boom time from 2000 to 2007. What happened after 2008? And exactly as John said, this is a time where there really aren't great sectors that are seeing a jump in their productivity growth. There is modest positive contributions to productivity across most of the industries, largely because of the fact that their employment has been low or declining. This is a time period when a lot of companies are feeling the uncertainty. Many of them have a lot of money on their balance sheets and they would like to invest, but they don't know where. There is uncertainty of where the growth is coming from. There is uncertainty about what's going to happen on their industries. And that's one of the factors that we don't really see an industry that has gone all out to invest and grow. And of course, we see the same, if you want, the cyclical macroeconomic impact on some of the productivity growth figures slowing down it as well. So that is the, if you look at the picture over the past, the way we interpret that picture is actually less than that we are seeing necessarily a trend declining productivity. If you look at the jolts and starts and accelerations and slowdowns across the different industries, there is really no reason to believe we wouldn't see some other industry come up with a big innovation and continue to push their growth and become the next engine of growth. Obviously, if that would be a large industry, that would make it a lot easier than the smaller ones where you need to see a very large acceleration in order to have that positive impact. And when we look across the globe, and we did that last year, we looked at actually globally the productivity opportunities, there is plenty of room in most industries to really dramatically increase their productivity. Let me give just two examples. The bubble here is just to illustrate that wherever we looked at, we saw those large opportunities. But if you look at the top right, for example, even agriculture. This is an industry where precision agriculture, sensors that detect what's the state of water, fertilization, et cetera, on the fields, has potential of increasing yields from 5 to 10%, even in the most advanced industries today, advanced planting areas today. And this is the reason why agriculture is actually by far the largest commercial end use for drones that people expect to have. It's the drones that are feeling and sensing what to do in the different kinds of fields. So that's an industry where you have significant improvements to still push the frontier where we are today. On the other extreme, on the bottom left, you can look at healthcare. This is an industry which is obviously large, has been a long history of slow productivity growth, and many of the kinds of operational improvements on how labor is used that we see in the private sector have really not been adopted. Optimization of when workers are working versus when the demand is for their activities, there is a big wide gaps between over and under utilization. In many cases, nurses might spend less than 40% of their time in direct patient care because of the fact that there is paperwork, there is transitions, there is things that can, with tools that have been already implemented in other parts of the economy, relatively easily improved. And I think there is very large opportunities across the board for companies to continue to improve productivity. And when we put that together, overall, we estimate that in developed economies, you could reach productivity growth rates of 2% a year over the next 10 years with just tools we can see right now. Half of that is actually simply by better diffusion of practices that we already know. So basically catch-up practices. Another half, a full percentage point, from pushing the frontier with the technologies that exist today or that already will are so close that we know they will be implemented in the next 10 years. So all of that is very good news. We don't see an end of productivity opportunities for businesses wherever we looked at. But it's clear that making change for businesses is hard work. It's not something that you do unless you have a clear carrot or preferably a stick to do. So what could be the kinds of factors that could lead us to see some jolts, spurts, productivity growth engines take up in different parts of the industry? The first one is regulation, regulatory changes. This has been liberalization, opening up of markets. This has been a big part of the productivity success of the last 50 years. There is more room. One space that we are definitely watching at, and I'm watching at, is the healthcare industry, where the Affordable Care Act, and particularly the rise of the exchanges, is actually changing the dynamics, because no longer are employers the only people who make decisions about healthcare plans. Now it's individuals as well who need to choose and who will be looking at the costs and benefits in a different way. At the same time, you see the younger generation of millennials being much more proactive in wanting to be active in their health, their own healthcare. So they really want to look at on the web and get information and make decisions and not just trust their healthcare providers as had been the case in some of the, more the case in the earlier generations. So regulatory change is definitely a space to watch. Another one is technology-enabled productivity growth. We definitely see the pipeline of technology innovations be stronger today than it has ever been. So, for example, we looked at the 12 technologies that could have a real disruptive effect on the economy. They are both large and significant, and these are across the board from Internet of Things to new materials to big data. And really, the challenge for companies is not that there isn't enough technology opportunities out there. It is the fact that they are coming from all directions is so fast that it's no longer enough to just follow the, if you want, the technology pipeline and keep up with your competitors. It is now of knowing which ones you need to react to, which ones are going to influence your business in what way, and where to invest. So the other, in addition to the uncertainty about the macroeconomic environment, there is also the uncertainty about where exactly you would want to invest. Companies don't know how to make their predictions, how to make the decisions on investments, and that's a big, big challenge. Third, increased competition. One of the things of the rise of the emerging markets we talk less about is the rise of emerging market companies. And there we estimate that we'll see the number of billion-plus revenue companies almost double to 2025, and 7 out of 10 of the new companies, 7,000 of them, will come from emerging markets. And just like the Japanese automakers or the South Korean consumer electronics companies have significantly increased competitive pressure and performance within U.S. companies, we are likely to see that across very many different industries in the future. So I think that's another potential that could jolt certain industries in different sequence to start growing. And last, there's a big part of other. Clearly, we have been, and that's the good thing about predicting the future. We are at a time where there is a lot of uncertainty and a lot of pessimism, I would say, about the economy. We can see that turnaround relatively quickly if animal spirits speed up. We might even see very different innovations, and this is the last example I'll share. So, for example, let's think about the impact of driverless cars. They will have many impacts on different parts of the industries. But let's think about one specific example, which is its impact on real estate in the largest cities in the U.S. Xie and Moretti have argued that the U.S. GDP would be 9.5% higher if we didn't have the constraints in land growth in San Francisco, New York, and other similar cities. How about if with driverless cars we no longer need all that parking? We can basically have the cars drop us off in our offices and our stores and have them drive further away. We release huge amount of land in some of the most attractive real estate assets in the world. This could be one area where we could see some pretty significant changes relatively quickly. We could have high-value activities grow up in the cities that we haven't seen grow as fast as we would like to see. So with that, I think in our view, we don't really see the world as a pessimistic, declining overall trend growth. There's a lot of things that are pushing against the global growth, demographics and aging being one of them. But from the industry productivity growth perspective, there is really no reason to believe that we couldn't see the kind of productivity spurts and growth we have seen in the past and that have surprised us in the past. Thank you.
Jana, thank you for a little bit of brightness and to the dismal science. Appreciate that. Peter, why don't you?
Thank you. I'm delighted to be with you. One mark of proficiency in Washington is the ability to answer the question that you want to have had asked rather than the one that was asked, while providing enough connective tissue not to make it totally obvious. So that's what I'm going to try to attempt to do, because this is about productivity, and the topic I'm going to discuss is related to productivity, but is a little bit tangential with a fair amount of connective tissue. What I want to urge us, including in the productivity debate, to do is to move beyond even the sectoral discussion that we have been engaged in so far, which I think is healthy, and move to a discussion at the firm level, because it increasingly appears to me that a lot of important macroeconomic phenomena are being driven at the level of the firm. Now, obviously, there are sectoral consequences to that observation, but we have to go even beneath sectoral analyses to really do the analysis right. So let me paint a picture for you, which I have to admit is still tentative, based on work with Jason Furman, and the paper is available out front, that suggests a much different perspective on some important forces affecting the U.S. economy than the traditional conventional wisdom suggests. The first factoid is that if you listen to most popular discussions, especially here in Washington, the rise in wage inequality in the United States is driven mostly by within-firm phenomena. That is, the CEO at each firm is earning X times more than the median worker at each firm. That ratio has gone way up, and that's the primary driver of wage and income inequality in the United States. The facts actually appear to suggest something quite different. This is a chart from Song et al., and I'm going to provide the caveats in a second. But what it shows is a very large increase in the between-firm rather than the within-firm inequality in wages. And actually, when you look at their initial paper, with a caveat in a second, it looks like the within-firm inequality, which is shown on the right, basically has shown no trend at all. That is, all of the increase in wage inequality in the United States is Apple versus Applebee's instead of the CEO at Apple versus the median worker at Apple. It's all between firm and not within firm. Now, some caveats to that. First, this is based on a series of cross sections rather than the full panel data, which would be the right way to do this analysis. It raises the concern, which the authors are in the midst of answering, that part of what's going on here is you previously had janitors at Apple that were part of Apple, and now they're part of some janitorial firm that contracts with Apple. That shows up as between firm, but it's sort of kind of really within firm. It does not appear that that's a big part of the story. So I'll just secondly note, there were concerns about the very top end of the firm distribution, that whether it was appropriately included in this analysis. And it does appear that when you include very large firms, the picture changes slightly. It's still that the bulk of the rise in wage inequality is between firm rather than within firm, but not 100%. And I don't think that debate is that important. Another paper by Richard Freeman et al. That used survey data suggested that something like two-thirds of the rise in wage inequality is between, not within firms. The point is that is a much higher share than the conventional wisdom would have suggested, and whether it's two-thirds or 80% or 90% is not material for the immediate purposes, for our immediate purposes. I would note, by the way, just as an example of this phenomenon, it comes back a bit to, and one of the hard questions here is what's driving this, which is what I'm going to get to. I would note over the past year, the shuttle bus drivers at Apple have experienced a 25% wage increase. I would suggest to you that if Applebee's employees, shuttle bus drivers, I don't know if they do, that they did not enjoy a 25% wage increase over the past year. And we have to ask ourselves, why is that happening? One of the leading explanations would be the old Kruger-Summers inter-industry wage differentials, that firms basically share some of their bounty with their workers. And that's the theme that I want to develop further as we move along. Second fact that's important is that, and this is directly relevant to our discussion today, is that under the surface, the underlying dynamism of the U.S. economy seems to be on the decline rather than the rise. So if you, the focus tends to be each month on the number of jobs created, for example, but that's the difference between two much larger numbers, the gross job creation rate and the gross job destruction rate. And if instead of focusing on the net number, you look at the trends in those gross numbers, which might be more informative with regard to underlying churn and dynamism in the labor market, you see this long-term seminal decline in gross job and gross destruction and creation rates in the United States. And consistent with that, on the right-hand side, we historically have been a country, or at least a self-perceived country, of movers. From one state to another, from one county to another, and so on and so forth. And geographic mobility has also been declining in the United States over the past several decades, as you can see on the right-hand chart. I would put to you that it's probably likely that these two phenomena are related to one another, that most people, especially of working age, move for a job. And so if gross job creation and job destruction rates are down, it's not surprising that geographic mobility rates are also down. I'd also note that there was a lot of discussion in the media about this decline around the time of the great financial crisis, thinking that it was linked to the mortgage crisis. But you can see this has been going on for a long period of time. It affects both renters and homeowners about equally. So one should not put too much emphasis on the mortgage crisis being the cause here. So how are these things related? And now let's try to link it back to the firm level perspective and productivity. The hypothesis that we put forward is that there has been a very substantial and little noticed change in the dispersion of performance at the firm level in the United States and perhaps elsewhere. And you can see that in a variety of ways. One is by looking at equity returns. You can see that the distribution in 2014 relative to the mid-90s has more weight in the upper tail, so there are more very high-performing firms. But obviously, equity returns can be affected by lots of things, especially the debt-equity mix that firms adopt, and so this is not a particularly useful perspective. What we think is a more useful perspective is to examine the return on invested capital, which will measure the return to both equity and debt capital. Providing a purer measure of firm operating performance. And here what you can see is that for publicly traded U.S. firms, and we exclude goodwill on purpose for the time being because this is a better measure of operating performance, and if superior operating performance were partially dissipated through value-reducing acquisitions, I don't want to incorporate that into the analysis. U.S. publicly traded firms, $500 million or more in revenue per year. This analysis actually comes from Tim Kohler, the data analysis at McKinsey. And what you see is the 90th percentile, and that's where I want to just focus for a second, massive increase in returns on invested capital. So in the mid-1960s, the top 10% of U.S. publicly traded firms were basically earning returns on invested capital of maybe 20% or more. Now there are 10% of U.S. publicly traded firms, non-financial firms, because the ROIC is harder to compute for financial firms, that are earning 100% or more returns on invested capital, excluding goodwill. I would say that is a very dramatic change in the dispersion of firm-level performance. A couple other points to make on this. First, you'll notice that the median hasn't really moved that much. And the mean has moved a little bit, but that is consistent with the productive capital share in the national income and product accounts not actually moving in the way that Mr. Piketty and others, or at least they have been interpreted as suggesting. It is interesting to note that all of the decrease in labor income basically mirrors an increase in the return to housing and land, not the return to productive capital. And that is reflected in this chart also because this is mostly a dispersion discussion. It's not a, it's a little bit of mean, but it's not a median story to a first approximation. Second, these very high return firms tend to be persistent. So maybe this would be a different thing if there were just firms bouncing in and out of very high return situations. If you take a threshold of 25% return on invested capital, just as being a arbitrary but high number, and look at the firms that were above that threshold in 2003, 85% of them were still above that threshold in 2013. Second, if you look at the high return firms, they are disproportionately in two sectors. One is information technology. I'll come back to that point in a second. Think Facebook or Google. They have very little invested capital, therefore very high returns on invested capital. And secondly, healthcare, but especially in pharma and not in the payer-provider space, which I'll also come back to in a second. So we have this picture of very high returns on invested capital. If I look at, if I include goodwill, you also see a big increase in dispersion, but it's less dramatic than what I had shown you before. And just to tie this all together, here is the new hypothesis that we would put forward for you to consider, admitting that there are leaps of faith along the way. I'll come back to that chart in a second. That effectively, most of the discussion about wage inequality in the United States assumes that each worker earns their marginal product. So there are some superstar individuals, they are thriving on a world stage, and they're getting very high returns as a result. What if instead of that, there are superstar firms? There are firms that are earning very high returns on invested capital. They are partially sharing those returns with their workers, which, by the way, these returns on invested capital are after labor compensation. So the pre-labor excess labor compensation data would suggest even more so. And that is fully consistent with a whole variety of evidence, including the Kruger-Summers inter-industry wage differentials, including the fact that when product markets were open to competition, for example, in airlines and what have you, you saw an effect on wages in those sectors, which would not, you wouldn't otherwise think would be the case unless you were effectively sharing rents. So there are superstar firms. They are sharing part of those returns with the workers that work there. That helps to explain the between firm variance in wage inequality rather than within firm. It would also be consistent with the reduction in labor mobility for two reasons. First, in order for those firm effects to persist, there has to be some sort of worker immobility behind it. And secondly, consistent with that, if you're on one of those rocket ship firms, you don't want to leave. And you may also want to discourage people from having the ability to jump onto them. That would also then be consistent with the decline in geographic mobility. So all of this is to say a big part of, I think, the research effort going forward has to dig down to the level of the firm, deeply related to productivity because it suggests that there are some firms that are basically at the global frontier that are thriving in today's environment, and then there are laggards that are not, and that's showing up in a whole variety of other settings also. It also raises deep questions about competition policy. In all of these sectors, and just to go back to this chart, we have seen a fairly significant rise in the concentration of industries in the United States. That's consistent with other evidence suggesting the number of publicly traded U.S. firms, for example, is about half of what it was 20 years ago, and that decline has not been offset by an increase in non-publicly listed firms. So just the number of firms in the United States is flat to down, not rising in line with GDP. But there's also another harder question, which is coming back to the Facebook issue. Should we think of Facebook as being a firm that is a productivity leader, technology and innovator, or is Facebook's return on invested capital persisting because there is a big barrier to entry in the form of the network that Facebook has built up? And how one evaluates that question, which has traditionally been a competition policy only kind of thing, may turn out to matter a lot for things like wage inequality, which is what not where you would have initially thought to go. So again, I want to be appropriately modest in terms of the linkages because not each piece of this story has been tied together nicely, but there are at least enough suggestive evidence for each of them that I think it might cause us to rethink how we approach many of these big questions. Final point I wanted to make is just to underscore one of the points that comes from the McKinsey analysis, now again separate from this, which has to do with healthcare, because it would be hard to imagine another sector where the best evidence suggests that we probably waste 5% of GDP on healthcare services delivered that don't improve health outcomes. That's a huge number. Our beloved Trans-Pacific Partnership might add, what, 10, 20 basis points to US 30? Okay, we're at the Peterson Institute, 50, whatever.
I'll go with 50.
50, okay. Tax reform, et cetera, all these things that we spend a lot of time in the policy world on tend to be, you know, a tenth of the waste in healthcare that is well documented in terms of massive variation across the United States that don't improve health outcomes. And I would just end on that note by pointing to an interesting set of findings suggesting that most of that variation, at least within Medicare, is in post-acute. It's not in hospitals. It's in everything else after the hospital setting. And interesting new evidence suggesting that the correlation between how much we spend and what we get in return is the most negative in that post-acute setting. So there's a lot that we can do to reap more value out of healthcare, and that's one of the, if we could get an extra 5% of GDP over the next 10 to 15, 20 years by wringing more efficiency out of healthcare, there's no doubt that that's one wind at our back with regard to the problem that we're discussing today. Thank you.
I'll take advantage of my prerogative as chair to just lead off with a few questions before we open it up to the audience as a whole. Let me start with Peter. You show this dramatic rise in the dispersion of returns to capital starting in the mid-1990s. Is there any economic or political factor that you could point to that would have led to such a dramatic change in behavior in that particular time period? And if so, does that lead to any particular prescriptions about policy that might address either barriers to entry or other kinds of rent-seeking activities?
So I guess there are two things that one could point to around that time. One is the much more dramatic growth in IT firms. And the second is this kind of accelerating concentration of U.S. industries. One driver of which, by the way, may be the rise of information technology, which gives a significant benefit to scale. Big data algorithms work a lot better when you have tons of data than when you have a little bit of data, and so it gives an emphasis to greater scale. I am not entirely sure what the policy ramifications are yet, in part because I think we need to do a better job of making sure that we fully understand exactly what's driving this. I would note that there is a, I don't want to call it a literature since there are only a couple papers, but there are a few analyses of a related topic, which I had mentioned, the dramatic decline in publicly listed U.S. firms. And what's driving that, because it seems to be mirroring the increased concentration and the increased dispersion of publicly traded returns. So I'm still hesitating with kind of firm policy conclusions, in part because we're not even entirely sure that the underlying story is right yet, but it's provocative enough that we think it's worthy of much more attention.
John, also ask a policy-related question of you as well. You really cited some very dramatic potential gains in terms of productivity growth going forward in getting firms to either push towards the frontier or by adopting technologies that are already available. What role is there for policy to play in expediting that push to the policy frontier? And how much of this is just going to take time for firms to adapt and behave themselves?
Great question. And we actually looked at that explicitly when we looked at it globally. We roughly estimated that close to a third depend on some kind of government actions. Some of that has to do particularly in the emerging markets on things like infrastructure, et cetera, that makes a big, there are more enablers if you want. But in across the developed regions, we estimated something like 13% of the productivity opportunities really do somehow depend on the government, whether it has to do with land use policies, for example, whether it has to do with, and this is across the private sector alone, whether it has to do with constraints on some service trading, service activities, et cetera. And clearly, I think, just to pick up on the healthcare industry, many of the industries continue to be, particularly the ones that have seen very low productivity growth, continue to be the regulated industries. And that really means that regulation that very explicitly thinks about the productivity implications can make a big difference.
Can I just quickly add, since I unfortunately answered the question that you asked, just to add, I think independently of how much of this story that I presented is right, just to highlight two things. One is housing use restrictions clearly are one of the things that are impeding geographic mobility and probably job mobility in the United States. It's largely not a federal issue, but a state and especially local issue. And you can see that in the data that many of the areas, if you think you're going to, you know, go to a high growth area, the rents, et cetera, and housing prices are artificially too high because of land use restrictions that should be addressed. And the second issue involves licensing. 25 years ago, 5% of the U.S. workforce was in a job that required a license. Today, it's closer to 30%. Part of that is because of the rise of healthcare and education, but that's only about a third of the rise in licensing requirements. We have a, you know, there's no reason that a dog walker who's licensed in Los Angeles shouldn't be a dog walker who's licensed in New York. And I don't even know why we have to license dog walkers or barbers or all these other things that are licensed. So there is a productivity impediment that arises because of the admittedly well-intentioned desire to protect consumers, but at some point it becomes counterproductive, and I think we're at that point.
Finally, for John, I think you make a persuasive case that for the market production, the measurement error issues may not be large. I wonder, though, if we couldn't be experiencing some more dramatic shift between what you would call market-based production and home production in ways that maybe we'll look back upon this period and recognize that, in fact, the kinds of things we always talked about in textbooks, the micro textbooks and macro textbooks early on about, well, this is just covering market-based, somehow the home production was always sort of in the background and not that important in terms of changes. But it's quite conceivable that some of the improvements in technology might be dramatically changing what you would broadly call home production in ways that are enhancing the quality of lives of people that might be, in fact, of economic significance. Is that possible? And what would be the implications of that?
Yes, and it's not the first time this has happened, that there were enormous engines of liberation, as some people have talked about it in the 20th century, in terms of vacuum cleaners and washing machines and dryers, not to mention refrigerators and other things that made it easier to produce, made us more productive in producing things at home, and that also made it possible to shift people from home to market aspect, so that when you look at the data, the total economic activity can look total economic activity per capita can look different over time than market economic activity per capita because you have that shifting barriers. So, I mean, that point starts wanting better data on this. We have now better time use data, but that's it's not perfect and it's relatively recent. But that this is going to be something that we're going to keep following, because it will change where people choose to spend time. Certainly, one hypothesis I've heard of people, I'm not sure who originated this, about why so many young people spend their 20s living in their parents' basements unemployed or out of the labor force is it's cheap to keep yourself occupied now if you're in the basement. You can play video games and communicate with friends. And so this, at least according to this hypothesis, in the past, you had to get a job to keep from being bored. And now you don't need to. So it may change the economic incentives in ways that in the future, when we look back, we'll think is important.
I mean, I guess I was thinking, certainly dancing cats and playing video games in the basement are probably a quality of life improvement for some people. But I look at my son and daughter-in-law with a young child, and every day a big truck comes up and produces a pallet of diapers out in front of the house that used to be on the way home from work. It was, fight through the traffic, you got to stand in line at the grocery store to get those diapers. Now all of a sudden they appear. And it's not just that, of course, it's, lots of ways in which we organize our lives. Whether or not that could be sort of filling in some of the shortfall we might be getting on the market side. Let me just open up now to the floor. We have a roving microphone for those of you near the front, but for those of you who are closer to the back, please go to the back microphone and we'll get to you there. Yes, right here at the...
John Van Rynen, London School of Economics. So mainly on Peter's presentation, I mean, I think, Peter, you're really on to something profound and important here. So let me throw in two other facts and also a policy question for you. So the stuff you're talking about also links to another literature which people are worried about, which is the decline in the fraction of GDP going to labor. And if you look at if you take the superstar firm story you said, that could also help explain that, because if what's happening is that these days more and more of output goes towards the firms offering better products or producing them more efficiently, this leads to increased concentration and more activities, high-profit firms, which also have a low labor share as well. So you could also help explain why there's this decline. In fact, some work that Larry Katz and David Alter and I have been doing suggests that if you actually decompose at the firm level where this fall of the aggregate labor share comes from, it comes exactly because more and more activity is being allocated to the kind of high-profit firms like Apple and Microsoft. And that's exactly kind of what's kind of happening, which could also help explain not just inequality between workers, but also between firms and workers as well. Also, if you look internationally, you see the same phenomena. So this dispersion of performance, you can also see happening in the UK and Germany where inequality has gone up. But that leads me to the policy question I'd like to ask you. So there's two ways of looking at this. You could say, well, for competition policy, we should get really tough because these kind of firms are earning supernormal profits. We need to start controlling that. The other view, and this harks back to a kind of old debate in IO, is if competition is increasing because of globalization technology, this allocation towards the more efficient firms actually is not something which necessarily is a bad thing at all, because you're actually moving the activity to the more productive, more successful firms. So I think that's a real tricky question for competition policy and general policy towards how we think about this. So I know what your views on that could be.
This has been a little bit of a puzzle for me because I'm interested in the Larry Katz has been promising these results for a while now, so I'm eager for your actual paper. But we have the potential to kind of over-explain the decline in labor share because on the one hand, it does appear that at least at the macro level, you can explain effectively all of the decline in labor share by the increase in the return to housing and land. And then secondly, we have a kind of more detailed firm level explanation, even within the productive capital share, it looks like there is this kind of reallocation. So it'll be interesting to see how those pieces fit together. But I think the point still holds, regardless of how you reconcile all that, that there is massive variation in labor share across firms. And it does look like output is shifting towards these, for lack of a better term, superstar firms with low labor share. With regard to the policy consequences, this is why I'm sort of torn, because it's exactly this tension. You don't want to discourage globally frontier firms from continuing to innovate and from having the incentive to be globally frontier firms. On the other hand, 100% return on invested capital looks like it's really high, and do you need that much incentive? I would say traditional antitrust competition policy type of interventions probably are too slow moving, backward looking, and not that well adept, not that well equipped to handle, especially something in IT or faster moving sectors. So there's a mismatch between the sort of traditional antitrust perspective and where this phenomenon is disproportionately occurring. Could we imagine a more progressive corporate income tax or a, you know, are there other interventions that might be sort of better attuned to this? Possibly. But again, I'm being very cautious here just because we're still, again, not entirely sure of the underlying story, let alone the policy consequences.
A quick comment, just an effect of the increased scale. Compare Detroit in 1990 and the three big companies there and Silicon Valley today. The revenues were roughly the same, $250 million. But when you look at the number of workers in the big three versus Google, Apple, and Facebook in Silicon Valley today, it used to be 1.2 million in Detroit. It's less than 150,000 in those three. So I think that's just an example, an illustration of the scale differences. They are pretty dramatic.
Thank you. Mike Prohl, independent economist. I make just a passing observation on the superstar IT firms, which is that they apparently, according to anecdote, hire only the superstar computer programmers and so on. So while I don't doubt the sharing of rent story is relevant, particularly if it extends to bus drivers and so on, there is this other competitive element there that might color things. Perhaps this is about on the level with getting into dog walkers. It may not be a big thing in the aggregate, but perhaps, John, you'd be the person to address this to. Post 9/11, I guess because of events in Paris, one's mind goes to this sort of thing once again. It seems like there's been an intensification of effort to protect people. After 9/11, you certainly saw an increase in private guards and buildings and processes at airports and a lot of other things that undoubtedly have gone on that have put sand in the gears of various activities. And a second somewhat related point, IT seems to be an interesting technology in that it brings with it the seeds of its own destruction, and we end up spending a lot of resources on cybercrime protection and so on. Now, I don't know whether these are big, but they're certainly, those have been growing sectors in this period when we've seen this deterioration in productivity performance, and I wonder whether that could potentially be of any quantitative significance.
I know after 9/11 there was some concern. There were concerns and some, you know, analysis of how much this might mean for productivity. Because obviously, as you're saying, you're then spending more, devoting more resources to things that are not aimed at production, but at non-production, essential but non-production activities. My recollection of the numbers were, you know, it was not huge relative to what we have seen, the swings we've seen in the data, that maybe you get a tenth, something on that order, is sort of the sort of thing I remember, which, of course, then that was, you know, 2002-03, productivity growth was enormously rapid, and so we didn't focus on that so much. But it's been, as you're suggesting, a steady, can be a steady drain. It potentially reduces dynamism. But of course, measures of dynamism that, you know, Peter talked about have been declining since the 1980s. So it's not the full story there either. But all of that, it's, you know, may end up impeding growth in ways that we don't pick up very well if the dynamism story is really important for that. When I think of the IT and the seeds of its own destruction, and I think of that when I think about, you know, why might we not get the optimist story of and just unbounded growth. Part of it is that we may have to spend a lot of resources, you know, just, you know, keeping bad things from happening. So we may not get all of the upside.
If I could just comment quickly on the comment, which is you absolutely are right that, in fact, the authors of the wage inequality story basically at this point think most of it's sorting and self-selection. We'll see, but what we do know is that the covariance between the firm effect and the worker effect has gone way up, and so the question becomes, why is that? And this is where the panel data will be much more informative than repeated cross-sections, because you'd really like to trace people throughout their whole careers and see, do you see big jumps in the wage that a star programmer earns when he or she moves from, you know, company A to Apple?
So a question I think primarily for John Furner, but others may want to comment on it. So two parts. The first is that, anecdotally at least, it looks as if in the most recent decade there have been important shifts towards just-in-time allocation of labor in many industries, less fixed-time allocation. And one would have thought that this would be associated with increase in productivity. Is there any sign of that in the data, and if not, why not? The second question is, when you underline the significance of the capital shallowing in the recent underperformance of productivity, does your work give us any insight into why, what it was that led to this extraordinarily weak period of capital accumulation relative to the aggressive hiring that began to take place, and therefore over what time frame or what set of conditions it might reverse?
Well, of course, the shifts in just-in-time, Yana may have a view from the firm level studies, but that would be in the data, and maybe I guess I would think of that as part of the ongoing incremental pace of technological improvements and of firms managing, finding new ways to be more efficient, and it's added up to 1.5 on labor productivity, 0.5% on TFP. So that's sort of in there if that's making them more. More productive in the sense of being able to have less time idle, being able to better match hours, working hours with the demands for labor. So you have less sort of labor hoarding even over the course of a week, not just over a business cycle. Now, in terms of the capital shallowing in the past 5 years, I mean that's come because hours have been growing at 2 or 2.5% a year. Much faster than demographics, because of course we started with lots of people who weren't working, who should have been working, and so you could pull them back into employment. Capital growth went slowed to about zero during the depths of the recession or right after it, and it's picked up a lot. It's back to 2%, 2.25, 2.5. So it's been it's slowly picked up. It's growing at a pace that is faster than probably sustainable hours growth. So that's why I think the hours growth is going to come down. So why didn't it pick up as fast? Partly because firms found they had lots of capital. They didn't need the capacity to continue to produce. I think the stories, lots of stories about uncertainty from various reasons, including Yana's story about the uncertainty about technology and where to invest may also, so not just macro uncertainty, but micro uncertainty may be high. But certainly the underlying pace of capital growth or capacity growth will sustain faster productivity growth going forward under the assumption that hours growth gets back in line with demographics.
At the back.
Very quickly, just on the just-in-time, we have seen that happen in manufacturing starting on the 80s and earlier. The real push really needs to be in services, where oftentimes you see the demand fluctuate over day, over week, etc. And I think there the speed of diffusion of labor allocation to match it perfectly when the demand is the one where the big opportunity is. And there is much more to go.
I'm Jason Lang with Reuters. This question that could be for any on the panel, it has to do with the graphic, the chart that Peter Orszag had on the superstar return on yield, or superstar firms for return on yield, drawn from the McKinsey data. I wonder, a couple of months ago, the OECD produced a graphic, some economists at the OECD produced a graphic on sort of superstar productivity gains on a firm level basis, and found that firms on the frontier were actually doing quite well in terms of productivity, especially in the service sector. And I wonder if any of you see that as related, if there's a potential tie between that and the return on yield graphic, and whether and if there is one, whether that would tell us something regarding the hypothesis that the return on yield has to do with rents, if it's consistent with that story, or if it maybe points to a different explanation for Mr. Orsak's graphic. Thank you.
Why don't I take a first crack at that? I think they're quite related, or they're potentially quite related. What the OECD study suggested was a surprising variance in productivity across firms between those that were at the global frontier and the laggards that were not. And the puzzle is, how do those differences persist over time, especially if the production technology, et cetera, is freely available, which it's not always the case. One hypothesis along that dimension comes back to some of the earlier discussion. The more that the world digitizes, the more that we're in Zipf's law kind of phenomena where big returns to scale and increasing returns to scale persist. And so it might be harder to jump to being globally frontier, even within a sector, than it was 20 or 30 years ago. I would also then just finally say on the rent story, just let's again be clear about what we mean by rents, because all we mean is that it's a payment to the firm or net profit to the firm above what would be required to have the firm continue in business. And so you can view a rent as being a massive global return to inventing some new thing that's above what you would have required in order to have the incentive to produce that new thing. So it doesn't necessarily mean that this was all done through nefarious, rent-seeking type of activities. It could just be the aftermath of innovation and other market structure phenomenon. Not entirely clear to me that the policy consequences differ all that much depending on that answer. I think we're back to the same question that was raised before, which is, how do you think of an IT firm with a big network? Is that positive because it provides resources to continue to innovate and be at that global frontier, or is it negative because it's effectively a monopoly at this point? And how should we deal with that from a policy consequence, from a policy perspective?
Abusing the chair's privilege, just to make two quick points. First, this literature that is growing up, and John Van Reenen and Peter and others and McKinsey have contributed to about superstars, there's also the trade literature on superstars, export superstars, which our colleague Carolyn Freund has been a major contributor to, and we're going to be publishing her book relating to that early in 2016. So it's all starting to pull together. And secondly, just to say with the good reference to the OECD work, if you look at your program, Dan Andrews from the OECD, who's been leading that effort, will be on the closing panel today.
I want to thank the panelists for their participation. I think we've had a very lively start to our day. Thank you very much.